Hi again, everybody. This is Del Brennan of BFRTS Sports in Washington. Today, it's the fifth and final game of the National League playoffs at Riverfront Stadium in Cincinnati, Ohio, between the Pittsburgh Pirates and Cincinnati Reds. We'll be joining Reds broadcasters Al Michaels and Joe Nuxtall for today's game, already in progress, in just a moment. This broadcast is authorized on the rights granted by the Pittsburgh Pirates and Cincinnati Reds solely for the entertainment of the AFRTS listening audience. Any publication, rebroadcast, or other use of the description and accounts of this game without the express written consent of the Pirates and Reds is prohibited. Rain delayed the game for an hour and a half. They're on the way now. It's the top of the second with Pittsburgh at bat. No score. Let's go to Cincinnati and Reds broadcaster Al Michaels.
Let's get a fly. Big break for the Reds as Hebner tees off. That's a double for sure and may score a run if it caroms the wrong way for Geronimo. Simply a strike and the count is 1-1. Best ball Hebner's hit in the series. It is still very, very overcast here in Cincinnati, but those are not rain clouds above us. Broken pattern for the first time today, so the forecast says no more rain. One and one the count. Belichick, a checker first. Back he comes. Up high ball two. 2-1. On deck, Dave Cash. Cincinnati nothing, Pittsburgh nothing in the second inning. Manny Sanguin at first base and nobody out. Gullett at the belt. Here's a 2-1 pitch on the way. Hebner, it's a line drive. This time it's there into the right field corner for a base hit. Geronimo cuts it off. Hebner is digging for two, and the throw is not in time. Gets by Cheney and gets by Mankey, and a run will score, and Hebner breaks the third, and he's in there. So the Reds, a defensive lapse as Morgan went out to cut the ball off, and it got by Cheney and Mankey, and rolls to the fence as the Pirates take a 1-0 lead. We'll see how they scored. It should be a double for Hebner and then an error, and we'll see who they give it to. Quite a heavy. Dave Cash is the batter. Runner at third and nobody out. Cash, a right-hand batter. Infield plays in. No run batted in on the play. Cash takes low and outside. Ball one. 1-0. So the Pirates draw first blood. It's 1-0 Pittsburgh. Richie Hebner at third base. And nobody out. Gullett ready. Back he comes. 1-0. Cash hits a ground ball up the middle for a base hit. And Hebner scores. It's 2-0 Pittsburgh. And the Reds will get busy in the bullpen. Pedro Bourbon will start to throw. So the Pirates on top. Johnny Bench going to the mound to talk with Gullett as Gene Alley comes up. Three straight hits, a single by Sanguin, a double by Hebner to right, a single by Cash, and the Pirates are on top with Gene Alley getting set to bat. Tommy Hall also starts to throw in the Reds bullpen. Hall a left-hander and Bourbon a right-hander. Shepard, the Reds pitching coach, will now visit the mound. Gene Alley, the batter, when play resumes, 0-for-12 in this series. So Gullett, a good first inning, and now he's getting rocked in the second inning. The other day, he got rocked in the first and then settled down. And off times, as Nux has mentioned time and again this year, Don's problem overthrowing the ball, and perhaps that's what Shep is talking to him about right now.
Well, I'm real sure this is exactly what Larry Shepard, the pitching coach, is talking to Don about. He again seems to be, as you say, overthrowing the baseball instead of relaxing and let it go. And I thought the first inning everything was all right, but all of a sudden here Sanguin hit a good pitch on him, a line drive to left, but these last two hits have been right there for him to hit.
Shepard back in the dugout. Gene Alley, the batter, hit 248 during the year. Three homers, 36 runs batted in. Cash, away to his lead at first. The stretch by Gullett. And the pitch to Alley is over for a strike. It's 0-1. This is the first time in the series that the Pirates have had the lead off the bat. Strike one pitch on the way. It's swung on, hit in the air to left center field. Colin is over and back to make the catch. One away. So Alley flies to center. He is now 0 for 13 in the series. And up comes Steve Blass, who hit 183 during the year.
Now, appears right now, they're just sitting on his fastball. They're just saying, well, I know he's going to throw it. I'm going to sit here and wait till he throws it up to two strikes.
Blass as a hitter the other day, 0 for 3, but it took a great catch by Rose to rob him of a hit in Pittsburgh in game one. Miller to the plate and Blass bunts foul, 0-1. On deck is Rennie Stennett. Pittsburgh 2, Cincinnati nothing in the second inning. Dave Cash at first base and one out. Hall and Bourbon in the bullpen. Menke ready to charge in from third. Perez at first. The outfield around toward right. Strike one pitch. Blast bunts foul again in the count 0-2. So Blast out of the box to check with third base coach Frank Osiak. Steve waiting. Gullett checks with bench. Don is set in the strike two pitch. Blass takes high around the bunt, letting it go by, and the count is 1-2. A single by Sandian, a double by Hebner, and an error charge to Cheney on the same play, producing one run, a single by Cash the second. Blass bunts foul, strike three. So Steve strikes out. Fires his bat back toward the dugout and is two away. Second strikeout for Gullett. Two down in the second inning, and up comes Rennie Stennett, who flied to right in the first inning. During the regular season, these two clubs met 12 times, with the Reds winning 8 out of 12. The Reds won 4 of 6 here at Riverfront Stadium. Rennie Stennett takes in the dirt. The ball bounces high off the plate to the backstop, and Cash goes to second. Takes the turn there and holds as bench retrieves. A wild pitch charged to Gullett. So Blass is unable to sacrifice, but Don Gullett throws the first pitch to the next batter, Stennett, away, and so the Pirates the same situation as if Blass had been successful. Runner at second, two down, 1-0 the count. Gullett getting some dirt out of his spikes, some mud. The mound, of course, covered during the delay, but it's still moist. It's taken some rain today. Gullett has to do some scraping. Now the left-hander looks in, takes a sign. Cash off to his lead at second, the stretch. Here's the 1-0 pitch on the way. He reaches out and fouls it away. Out of play, 1-1. Sparky Anderson has said that any pitcher is available to work today except Ross Grimsley, who went yesterday, and Gary Nolan, who pitched Monday. Gullett ready. Here's the 1-1 pitch on the way. In the dirt and blocked by Bench. A save of a wild pitch by Johnny, and the count is 2-1. Oliver on deck. Gullett ready. Here's a 2-1 pitch on the way. Swung on, grounded sharply to Menke. Stays with it at third. Straightens up, throws him out. He's side to side. Stennett hit a bullet on one hop, but right to Menke. And the Pirates are down in the second. They get two runs. Both are earned. Three hits. There was one error. One runner left on. At the end of an inning and a half, Pittsburgh 2, Cincinnati nothing.
Since we joined the game in progress, let's go back over what you missed the first inning at Cincinnati. The game began 1 hour and 28 minutes after its scheduled 3 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time starting time, with a very light drizzle still falling. Stennett led off, flat out to Geronimo in right field. Oliver was called on strike. Clemente singled up the middle, and Stargell popped to Perez at first base to end the first inning. For Pittsburgh, no runs, one hit, no errors, and one left. In the home first, Pete Rose led off, grounded out, cash to Stargell. Joe Morgan second up, flat out to Oliver on the warning track. And then Dave Cash threw out Tolan. So for the home first for the Reds, no runs, no hits, no errors, and none left. And as you heard in the top of the second, Pittsburgh came up with two runs on three hits and one error. That's where we are right now, the middle of the second, with Pittsburgh out in front, 2-0, and this, of course, this game decides the National League champion to face either Detroit or Oakland. As the Tigers won dramatically, we'll talk more about that later, 4-3 today in Oakland.
Bottom of the second inning, Pittsburgh leading 2-0. The Reds will send up Johnny Bench, Tony Perez, and Dennis Winkie. Bench is 4-for-14 in this series. Johnny hit 270, led the majors in homers with 40, and in runs batted in with 125. Outfield deep, well around toward last. Steve Glass to the plate with a slow curve. First strike on the outside corner, 0-1. Glass, a big motion, a quick motion. And his change off that motion is very effective. The next pitch, a blooper ball, swung on and popped up in the air. Right side of the infield, Stargell is waiting and falling and makes the catch. One away. We've seen Blast do it. We saw him do it in New York. Not quite an Ethers pitch, but sort of a balloon ball. Throws it up in the air and entices the batter, and Bench, fighting at it, popped out.
Well, Al, of course, any changeup or off-speed pitch, the motion is just as important as the speed of the pitch. He has good motion.
Tony Perez, the batter, fouls the first pitch back to the screen, and the count 0-1. Perez in this series is 3-for-16. Tony, during the year, hit 283 with 21 home runs, 90 runs batted in. Strike one pitch on the way. Fastball swung on and missed, and the count is 0-2. On deck, Dennis Minkie. Pirates 2, Reds nothing. One out, bases empty, bottom of the second. Blast with a sign, and the strike two pitch to Perez is just off the plate outside. Ball one. 1-2. The Reds coaches, Alex Gramish at third, George Scherger coaching at first. Blast heaves a sigh, looks in and takes a sign from Sanguian. The right-hander is ready, and the 1-2 pitch on the way. Perez takes low, ball two, 2-2. In Blass's game on Saturday, when he won, he pitched 8 1/3 innings, allowed 1 earned run, 8 hits, walked 4, and struck out 1. Here's a 2-2 pitch to Perez, taken just off the plate outside. They check it first, and nope, it's a ball, according to the umpire, Kibler, broke out. Perez tried to hold up in time and just barely did. So a full count, 3-2 on Perez. Minkie waiting on deck. The wide by Blast, and the pitch is swung on and missed, strike three. Got him on a fastball. Blast gets his first strikeout. Two down. Steve has set down the first 5 men he has faced, and the batter is Dennis Minkie. Minkie is 3-for-13 in this series. Denny hit 235 this year, 9 home runs, 50 runs batted in. The wide by Blast, and the pitch to Minkie is hit foul, off to the right, back out of play, 0-1. Blast ready to work again, strike one pitch on the way, fastball foul back again, 0-2. Geronimo waiting on deck. 2-0 Pirates, 2 out, bases empty, bottom of the second. Blast ready, and a strike two pitch on the way is outside, a slider misses, ball one, 1-2. Steve from Canaan, Connecticut. The line of the 1-2 pitch on the way is outside, slider missing, ball two, 2-2. Blast working with 3 days rest. During the season, he mainly worked with 4 days rest. Steve, 30 years old, 6-footer, weighs 170. The right-hander winds, and the 2-2 to Minkie is outside, ball three. So Blast goes to his second full count, 3-2 on Denny. His motion, and the 3-2 pitch to Minkie is grounded foul outside third. Count holding. Blast, a 19-game winner with the Pirates this year, led the staff in victories. Was going for 20 against the Mets in his last start, but got hit on the elbow and had to leave the game. 3-2 pitch is high, ball four. So the Reds have their first base winner, Glass got two quick strikes on Mickey and then Watson. We pause for station identification.
This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.
5 o'clock in the afternoon in the east. They start Geronimo the batter. Left-hand hitter. They're 275 this season. First pitch is swung on and grounded sharply to Stargell. He stays with it, steps on first, and the side is retired. So Stargell makes the play unassisted. The Reds go out in the second. No runs, no hits. One runner left on at the end of two. Pittsburgh 2, Cincinnati nothing.
In those totals for the American League playoff game today, won by Detroit. They'll have a sudden death thing tomorrow coming up at Detroit again. Tigers, 4 runs, 10 hits, 1 error. Oakland, 3 runs, 9 hits, and 2 errors. Hill the winner. Harlan the loser. Vita Blue pitched so well in the inning before, in the ninth inning, was taken out for a pinch hitter. Bob Locker came in to pitch for Oakland. They call up single to right. K-line single to left for the Tigers. They call up stopping at second. Joe Horland came in to pitch for Oakland. Gates Brown batted for Stanley. They call up advanced to third base, and K-line to second on the wild pitch. Brown walked in a 3-2 pitch to load the bases. Dave Hamilton warming up for Oakland. Bill Freehand grounded the bando. It was through to Tennis for an attempted force out on Brown at second, but Tennis dropped the ball for an error. Nagala scoring to make the score 3-2 and leaving the bases loaded. Hamilton came in to pitch for Oakland. Cash walked in 3-2 pitch to force in K-line with a tying run, and then Jim Northup stepped up, hit a fly ball over the head of Matty Alou in right field to score Brown and give Detroit that 4-3 win.
Third inning in the game that will decide the National League champion. It's 2-0 Pittsburgh, and for more play-by-play, Joe Nutsall.
All right, Al, thank you. It'll be Al Oliver, Roberto Clemente, Willie Stargell in the third inning for the Pirates. Oliver struck out in the first inning. He was called out on strike. In the championship series, Oliver, a .294 batting average. He's had 5 hits and 17 times to the plate, 4 of them for extra bases, 2 doubles, a home run, and a triple. First pitch, check swing, ground ball. Menke backhands a third in the fifth, throws to Perez, one away. Menke, two fine defensive plays already this afternoon. A shot off the bat of Stennett to wind up things in the second inning. And a good example of what can happen when the turf gets wet here. That ball is picking up speed once it hit the turf. To Menke off the bat of Stennett. One away, and here's Roberto Clemente. Clemente singled to center field in the first inning. Pirates 2, Reds nothing. Don Gullett has struck out 2. The Pirates have had 4 hits. Clemente takes down lower ball. Well, it was kind of the opinion of everyone. The team had got the breaks this afternoon would win it, and Pirates have certainly gotten one already. 1-0 down low. It's 2 balls, no strike. The ball hit by Hebner down the right field line the second inning. Geronimo's throw to second base trying to cut down Hebner. And 0-1 covering at second. The ball going into foul territory. And a run scoring. And Hebner winding up at third. Clemente swings and hits one to center field. Bobby Tolan steps back a couple of steps. Makes the catch. 2 away. 2 down. And here's Willie Stargell. Stargell in the first inning popped out to Perez at first base. Stargell has had 1 hit and 12 times to the plate. A double. And has driven in 1 run in the championship series. He has an 0-83 batting average. Gullett into his windup. His first pitch is over for a called strike, a breaking ball. So it's the final game of the championship series. Sliders outside, 1-1. Of course, the Tigers coming from behind to beat Oakland 4-3 this afternoon in 10 innings at Tiger Stadium. So 1-1, Stargell takes a curve that's low, and it's 2 balls to strike. Gullett on the year, 1-9 and lost 10. His 2-1 delivery, slider outside. 3-1 the count to Willie Stargell. Manny Sanguine waiting on deck with 2 away. Gullett 3-1 delivery, swung on and hit off the fist, popped into foul territory. territory. Joe Morgan moving behind Perez makes the catch, and that's all for the Pirates in the third as they go down in order. Nothing across, and it's the middle of the third inning here at Riverfront Stadium in Cincinnati. It's Pittsburgh 2, Cincinnati nothing.
A spokesman for the Philadelphia Phillies said Tuesday that the National League Club had not decided on a new manager yet and would not until at least after the World Series make any announcement. The spokesman denied that general manager Paul Owens has tabbed Dave Bristol, former Milwaukee Brewers and Cincinnati Reds skipper, for the job. Owens and Bristol met during the weekend in Pittsburgh at the National League playoffs, but it was not a formal interview. Said the spokesman, Dave has indicated he is interested. And he also added that Paul will interview him, meaning Owen, as well as four or five others in the next week to 2 weeks. He reiterated that he won't name a manager until after the World Series or until the end of the month. The manager, Owens, formerly the Philadelphia Phillies farm director, was named the GM last season after John Quinn was fired. So that's the latest on the new manager for the Philadelphia Phillies.
For the Reds in the bottom half of the third, Darrell Chaney, pitcher Don Gullard, and Pete Rose. Chaney in the championship series hitting 167, two hits and 12 times the plate. Steve Blass, his first pitch, a fastball over for a called strike. Steve Blass, 19-8 on the regular season. His 0-1 delivery, change curve in for called strike two, and Blass out in front, 0-2 to Darrell Chaney. Blass winning one of the two victories the Pirates have had in the series, winning the opener for Pittsburgh, 5-1, eight in the third inning. Here's the 0-2. Missing outside with a fastball. It's one ball, two strikes. An hour and 30-minute delay before the game started. 1-2 delivery. Change is swung on, line to right field, and a hit. Roberto Clemente takes it on the first bounce, and Dale Cheney gets the first hit for the Reds off Steve Blass. Blass throwing a slow curveball, and Cheney staying back on it and lining into right field. Well, Chaney leads off the inning with a single, and here's Don Gullett. Gullett was 1-for-2 Saturday in Pittsburgh. He had a single up the middle in the center field. Blass, the stretch, having a shallow at third, expecting the bunt. He does, squares bunt, first base side. It works. Blass has it, goes to Chaney, covering the first base. And down to second base goes Darrell Chaney. The play goes 1-4 on Don Gullett. And here's Steve Rose with one out and Chaney at second base. Rose in the first inning grounded to Chaney. Steve, the leading hitter in the championship series. Rose has a .471 batting average. He's had 8 hits and 17 times in the plate. Next to Keith is, well, let's see. And the Reds club is Bobby Poland hitting .294. Blast the stretch. Looks back at Chaney. Delivers to Rose. Pete swings and bounces it.
Fair. Over the head of Seidel. And that'll score on. Rose on his way to second. Seidel up with the ball. No play. And into second base goes Pete Rose. So what looked like a routine ground ball in the sliding bit and bounces over the head of Willie Seidel. Willie getting the glove on it but couldn't control it. And that'll be a base hit for Pete Rose. So a break for the Cincinnati Reds.
Boy, oh boy. Wild baseball here the last week in this championship series in both places. The American League and the National League. So Dale Chaney scores from second base. Give Pete Rose the double, his ninth hit in the championship series. It's a 2-1 ball game, and Joel Morgan steps to the plate. Morgan in the first inning sent Oliver to the warning track in center field, all in his fly ball. Rose at second, one out, 2-1, Pirates lead. Blast to the belt, looks back at Rose, delivers to Morgan, a change curve, up high, it's 1-0.
Reds now with two hits off Steve Glass. The outfield around to the right. Glass set, and his pitch to Morgan is low and inside. It's two balls, no strike. Boy, there's some sized up baseball fans here at Riverfront Stadium this afternoon. 2-0 the count to Morgan. Bobby Poland on deck. Morgan has hit two home runs in this series. The 2-0 delivery. Joe swings and pulls it deep down in right field. Clemente going over. It is a foul ball. And by a very little margin. No more than 3 to 4 feet at the very most. And we almost thought the Reds were going to be in front 3-2. But a long strike. So the count, two balls, one strike to Joe Morgan. Some kind of racket here at Riverfront Stadium. Cheering on every pitch. Glass ready with his 2-1 delivery. Here it is. Morgan swings and fouls. Backing out of play and the count evens at 2-2. Bobby Poland standing on deck. Rose at second base. One away. Hired. Scoring two in the second. The Reds have picked up one here in the third. Pirate outfield giving Morgan a lot of room down the left field line. Joe, a poor hitter. And Allie almost behind the bag at second, the shortstop. All right. 2-2 delivery. Change is swung on and bounced slowly to Cash. He charges, has it, underhands it to Sargent on the play. Rose moves over to third base. Morgan out, 4-3. Two away, and Bobby Poland steps to the plate. Poland in the first inning. Grounded to Cash. That was Blass's slow curveball. Morgan actually double hitching on it, but still hitting a soft ground ball. Tolan in the series is hitting .294. He's had five hits and 17 times to the plate. He's driven in four runs, a double and a triple. He leads the Reds in that department. Next is Joe Morgan with three. Johnny Bench has driven in one, and Tony Perez has driven in two runs. Rose has driven in one, now two. Here's the first pitch to Poland, swung on and foul. Slider, low and inside. The count 0-1. Pete Rose at third base. Rich Hebner's in shallow at third, knowing Poland will bunt. It's 0-1. The count. Blast into the windup, his pitch. Bob swings, slow bouncer, first base side. Blast off the mound, has it. Throws to Stigel, and that's all for the Reds. But in the inning, they pick up one run on two hits. There were no Pirate errors. One runner left on base at the end of three. It's the Pirates 2, the Reds 1.
The Pittsburgh catcher Manny Sanguin has to keep on his toes with the fast base runner Cincinnati has. And Bucks manager Bill Verdon commented on this catcher just before the game today.
The only difference I can see in Sanguin's throwing is he hasn't thrown as many strikes as he did in years past. Now, how come, I don't know. Maybe it's because the pitchers aren't holding him close enough and he has to hurry a little bit more. That's possible, but still the catcher's job, whether the pitcher has held the runner close or not, is still to catch the ball and to throw the ball where the second baseman can handle it. And in the past, I think Sanguin's been in 100%. I think this year he's been off just a little bit. But I'm not concerned about it in the series. They've got some good runners, and Sanguin's a good catcher and a good thrower, and let the best club have the best advantage, and I still think that's going to be on our side.
Bucks manager Bill Verdon talking about his catcher, Manny Sanguin. Pete Rose stole a couple of bases on him yesterday, and he hasn't been exactly sharp on his throws down the second thus far.
Three inning totals, Pittsburgh, two runs, four hits, no errors. The Reds, one run, two hits, and one error. Manny Sanguin will lead off the fourth for Pittsburgh. Back for the action, Al Michael.
All right, Nux, Sanguin, Hebner, and Cash, the 5-6 and 7 hitters coming up, and those were the hitters that did the damage in the second inning when the Pirates scored both runs. Pittsburgh, two in the second, Cincinnati, one in the third, 2-1 Pirates, and in the fourth inning, Sanguin leading off, singled in the second. He's 4-for-13 in this series. A .298 hitter during the regular season with seven home runs. 71 runs batted in. Reds play him around toward right. Manny Sanguin, born in Panama, now living in Pittsburgh. Never played baseball until he was 19 years old. Swings, it's a ground ball up the middle for a base hit. So the free-swinging Sanguin, who likes to go after the first pitch, does so here and lines his second base hit. Actually grounded it up through the middle for the fifth hit for the Pirates. And his fifth hit in the series. Richie Hedner will be the batter. And in the bullpen, left-hander Tommy Hall and right-hander Pedro Bourbon, who are up and working in the second inning, are working again. Richie Hedner missed lining one fair down the right field line by less than a foot in the second inning and then lined one fair for a double. Swings at the line drive to center. Tolan coming on has to play it on a hop. It's a base hit. And Sanguin stops at second. So Hedner has three hits in the series, all against left-handers, and the batter is Dave Cass. Bench goes to the mound. Cash singled in the second inning. So Gullit today has had no trouble with Stennis and Oliver and Stargell. Clemente has a hit, but the damage has been done by Sanguin, Hedner, and Cash. The 5-6 and 7 hitters. The Pirates runners at first and second. Nobody out. Cash the batter. He singled in the second inning to drive in a run. He's 3-for-16 in the series. Sparky Anderson is going to the mound. And, of course, today Sparky will waste no time going to the bullpen. He and Johnny Bench have a signal. If Bench doesn't think the pitcher has the type of stuff necessary, he will look over and give Sparky a certain sort of look. And that will bring a pitching change if Bench gave him that look. Right now, Sparky is out at the mound, and it looks like he is stalling for time. I would have to guess at this point. He's looking toward the bullpen where Hall and Bourbon are throwing. The plate umpire, Donatelli, is out there to try to speed things along. And now Sparky signals to the bullpen. He wants Bourbon. So Gullit has to leave. He goes three innings plus. And Don is charged with two runs. The two men on base are his responsibility. He gave up six hits. No walks and two strikeouts. So Sparky Anderson has to go to the bullpen early. And Pedro Bourbon, the right-hander from the Dominican Republic, on to work. It'll be his third appearance in the series. Bourbon pitched in the first game Saturday in Pittsburgh and retired all six men he faced on ground balls. Did not pitch Sunday, but then worked on Monday. Faced three men Monday. He faced Hebner and hit him with a pitch. He faced Sanguin and gave up a single, and then Alley sacrificed, and Bourbon came out, so he has no decision in the playoffs so far. He's worked a total of two in the third innings, allowing one run and one hit, no walk, and no strikeouts. Pedro Bourbon, who this spring was really a long shot to make the Reds pitching staff, acquired a couple of years ago in the Alex Johnson trade from the California Angels, was with the Reds briefly in 70, briefly in 71, but spent most of 71 in the minors in Indianapolis. Came to spring training and was given a chance to make the club and had a tremendous spring, and they kept him. And Bourbon was one of the more valuable and certainly one of the more underrated Reds of 1972 as he worked his duties in long relief, short relief, middle relief, even started the game. So Bourbon has a rubber arm and can really pitch every day. He's one of those types. Gets set to face Dave Cash. Fourth inning, 2-1 Pittsburgh. Nobody out. The Pirates have Manny Sanguin at second and Richie Hebner at first. Mankey in shallow at third. The pitch to Dave Cash is swung on and grounded foul. Off to the left, 0-1. On deck, Gene Alley. Pittsburgh, two runs, six hits, and no errors. The Reds, one run, two hits, and one error. Mankey now with Cash swinging away on the first pitch. Then he backs up a couple of steps. The next pitch is looped into left center field. That's in for a base hit. Tolan cuts it off. Around third comes Sanguin. He scores to make it 3-1. Hebner stops at second. So Dave Cash a base hit, and the 5, 6, and 7 hitters do it again as all three of them come through with hits. The Pirates runners at first and second, still nobody out. And the batter, Gene Alley, who flied to center in the second inning. Last comes out on deck. So Cash has his second run batted in, and the Pirates are on top by two. They have seven hits in three innings plus. Hebner at second, Cash at first. The pitch to Gene Alley is up high, ball one. Tommy Hall throwing in the Cincinnati bullpen. Outfield shading Alley toward right. In the series, Alley is 0 for 13. Bourbon back to the plate. Breaking ball hit in the air to right center field. Cesar Geronimo moving over. He's there to make the catch, and the runner's hold. One away. That brings up Steve Blass, who tried to bunt in the second inning and bunted foul to strike out. Johnny Bench going to the mound. As Blass comes up in what figures to be a bunt situation. Perez in shallow at first base. Minky has to hold back at third, then even with a bag. Cheney and Morgan each up a couple of steps. Bourbon checks with Bench. Pedro a long look at John and now steps off the rubber. Wants a new set of signs. Hebner away to his lead at second. Cash off first. 3-1 Pittsburgh. One out, two on, fourth inning. Extended on deck. Bourbon at the belt, and his first pitch to Blass. He swings away, hits a grounder to Morgan at second. Cheney one, back to first, double play. So the Pirates get three hits and a run, and then Bourbon gets Alley and Blass, and the inning is over. The Pirates, a run, three hits. They leave one. At the end of three and a half, it's Pittsburgh 3, Cincinnati 1.
The manager of the Tidewater Tide, Hank Bauer, today was named Manager of the Year in the AAA International Baseball League. He beat Louisville manager Darryl Johnson by one vote in a poll of the league's baseball writers. The poll was announced in Rochester, New York today. Under Bauer, the Tide finished third in the league, but won the Governor's Cup in postseason play. Bauer, of course, had the Baltimore Orioles in the World Series a few years ago. Bauer, formerly with the Yankees, among other teams, and of course, Darryl Johnson also at one time was in the Yankee organization. Taking a look now at what happened in the National Basketball Association opening night on Tuesday, Baltimore Bullets over Cleveland 102-90. Atlanta Hawks defeated the Buffalo Braves 120-109. The New York Knicks upending Seattle 113-89. And there was the Chicago Bulls in the low-scoring game, at least for NBA caliber. The Bulls 95 and the Philadelphia 76ers, 89. Looks like we'll have a high-scoring game here in the final game of the National League playoffs of Cincinnati as we return to Riverfront.
Bottom of the fourth inning at Cincinnati. This is Al Michaels with Joe Nuxall, and we hope you've been enjoying our broadcast of the National League Championship Series. Great pleasure for us to go out not only on the Reds Baseball Network, but all around the country, even out to Hawaii and around the world on American Forces Radio. Johnny Bench, Tony Perez, and Dennis Minky in the bottom of the fourth inning. Bench popped out in the second. Johnny is 4 for 15 in the championship series. Steve Blass into his windup, and his first pitch to Bench is down low, ball one, 1-0. Don Gullett, you can close the book on Don. He worked three innings plus, charged with three runs, six hits, no walks, and a pair of strikeouts. 1-0 to Bench. Johnny takes up and in. Ball two, 2-0. Gene Alley pulled over toward the hole at short. Hebner is backed up at third. Cash plugging up the middle at second. Sargent about 15, 17 feet off the line at first, and the outfield very deep and around toward left. 2-0 pitch to Bench. Johnny swings, grounds it sharply to Hebner at third. Richie stays with it. His long throw in plenty of time. One away. Bench gone, and the batter, Tony Perez. Getting the Reds, for the most part, hit the ball on the ground today. The other day, the Reds were hitting almost everything in the air off Steve. Tony Perez struck out in the second inning. Right-hand batter waits at the plate, swings, lifts it in the air down the right field line and foul ground. Sargent coming over to the seats but won't have a play. It's back in about the fourth row. On one. first three, Reds one, one out, bases empty, bottom of the fourth. Blass standing on the first base side of the rubber, rocks to his motion, strike one, pitches a changeup, hits a deep left foot foul, back out of play. 0-2. Blass with his full assortment today, fastball, slider, the curve that he calls the slop drop, the change in the blooper pitch. Strike two pitch on the way, fastball missing low, ball one. 1-2 on Tony Perez. On deck, Dennis Mickey. The wind by Blass. 1-2 pitch to Perez, got him swinging. Tony strikes out for the second time. They've been able to handle Perez in this series. Tony now 3-for-18. Two down in the fourth inning, and Dennis Mankey the batter. Mankey walked in the second after Blass had him 0-2. The right-hander delivers outside and low, ball one, 1-0. On deck is Geronimo. Pittsburgh, three runs, seven hits, and no errors. Cincinnati, one run, two hits, one error. Blass back to the plate, 1-0. Mickey reaches out and grounds it to short. Allie has to wait, throws to first in time. Then he tried to check his swing and rolls out to the shortstop. So Blass now has set down five in a row. The Reds go out in order in the fourth inning. And at the end of four full, Pirates three, Reds one. Inning, 3-1 Pirates, top of the order. Rennie Stennett to lead off for the Bucks, takes the first pitch on the outside corner for a strike. Pedro Bourbon working in relief of Don Gullett. He'll face Stennett, Oliver, and Clemente. The next pitch is a fastball inside, 1-1. Stennett has flied to right and grounded to third. In the series, he is 5-for-19. Bourbon ready. Back he comes, 1-1. Breaking pitch just missing. Ball two. Bench upset about the call. 2-1. Mankey even with a bag at third. 2-1 pitch. Swung on and missed, and it's 2-2. Stennett, like Sandin from Panama. Signed as an outfielder. Played the infield when he first came up with a box. Second base. Man in this series, he started every day in left field. Here's a 2-2 pitch on the way. Breaking ball, chopped on two hops to Perez at first. He flips to Bourbon, covering in time. Pedro almost overran the bag. 3-1. One out and Oliver the batter. The Cincinnati Reds urge you to support your local United Appeal campaign in Cincinnati and throughout the nation. This is a time for sharing with your neighbors during the National United Appeal campaign. Al Oliver struck out and grounded out in two trips. Left-hand hitter, 0-for-2, swings, hits a high fly ball to deep left. Rose started in, has to back up, has room, and makes the catch. Two down. Left field, which was such a problem yesterday, is no problem today with the overcast skies. Lights are on. That's a problem here, though, in the outfield. There's a spot in left center and in right center where the ball will get in your eyes, and it's happened on occasion this year. We've seen several balls lost in the lights. Two down, Roberto Clemente, the batter, singled in the first, flied out in the third. 1-for-2. Bourbon's first pitch is fouled back, 0-1. Clemente is 4-for-16 in the championship series. A single and a homer yesterday and a single today. Bourbon back to the plate. Fastball very high. By bench and all the way to the backstop. 1-1. Two out with the bases empty in the fifth inning at Riverfront Stadium. Pirates leading 3-1. Here's the 1-1 pitch on the way, fouled straight back to the screen, and it's 1-2. I would imagine when the Reds come up in the fifth inning, Sparky Anderson will have somebody loosening up in the bullpen. Bourbon is due to bat third when the Reds hit in the bottom of the fifth. 1-2 pitch on the way. Breaking ball just missing outside. 2-2. The Pirates, 2 in the second, 1 in the fourth. The Reds scored in the third. The wind by Bourbon. And the 2-2 to Clemente. Got him looking. Ball strike three. Roberto out on strikes. Bourbon gets his first strikeout. Pedro has set down 5 in a row. And the Pirates, for the first time, the second time in the game, go out 1-2-3. No runs, no hits, and nobody left after 4.5. It remains Pirates 3, Reds 1.
Now this message on behalf of the Survivor's Benefit Plan for Servicemen.
Military members can now provide an automatic survivor income of up to 55% of retired pay to widows and dependent children. The Survivor Benefit Plan, SBP as it's called, also allows persons retired to provide on a voluntary basis the same protection to their families. The program includes members of the reserve components of the Army National Guard and Air National Guard, with participation starting at age 60 when retired pay starts. The government pays a substantial part of the cost of the new SBP, making reductions in a retiree's pay smaller for the amount of family protection gained. If you're a career member of the armed forces right now, find out about the new benefits available to your family through the Survivor Benefits Plan. It's a way to buy time. Time to get your family off on a good start. Time to finish the job that you may not be able to finish yourself. The Survivor Benefit Plan is another reason why a career in the armed forces is a good deal.
Have the upper hand as they lead 3-1. Bottom of the fifth inning and the bottom of the order for the Reds. Cesar Geronimo, Darryl Chaney, and then Pedro Bourbon do up. Sparky Anderson in the dugout, and he is talking with Ted Ulander. So that's the tip-off as to who will hit for Bourbon. In the bullpen is left-hander Tommy Hall. Cesar Geronimo swings on a changeup and drills it to deep right. Back goes Clemente. She's gone. To Darryl is rolled foul toward first base. 0-1. Ulander on deck to hit for the pitcher Bourbon. Chaney singled in the third when the Reds scored their other run. So it's the Pirates 3 and the Reds 2 as Cesar Geronimo homers. Nobody out. Bottom of the fifth. The next pitch to Chaney in for a strike and it's quickly 0-2. Strike two pitcher on the way. Chaney swings and misses strike three. Blast gets his third strikeout. One out in the fifth inning, and Ted Ulander comes up to bat for Pedro Bourbon. Ulander, in his first season with the Reds, started very few games. He was the 10th leading hitter in the American League last year with Cleveland. He had 288. He was traded for pitcher Mill Wilcox. For the Reds this year, though, Ulander had 159. No homers, 6 runs batted in. It's the second time he's been up in the playoffs. He was a pinch hitter on Saturday in Pittsburgh and singled the left. He's a good bunter. The pitch to Ulander is low, ball one. 1-0. On deck is Pete Rose. Pirates 3, Reds 2, 1 out of the fifth. The next pitch, Ulander takes a strike and the count is even, 1-1. So Bourbon goes 2 innings, gives up no runs, 1 hit, no walks, 1 strikeout, and Tommy Hall will pitch the 6th. Here's a 1-1 pitch. Ulander takes outside, just missing. Ball 2, 2-1. Blatt has given up 3 hits in 4 1/3 innings. He's walked 1 and struck out 3. Here's a 2-1 pitch to Ulander. Outside, ball 3. 3-1. Ulander looking at third base, coach Alex Stramitz. Outfield is shading him toward left. Hebner is playing in front of the bag and close to the line at third. When Geronimo hit his home run, he was 1-for-17 in the series.
Now there's no question in my mind. I think Tatar went up to the plate and said, I'm going to wait until he throws me it. And he threw it to him on the first pitch, and Tatar hit a rope out of here. And this ball game, I tell you, I think it's going to be a wild one. I don't know who's going to win, but it's going to be a wild one, I'm afraid.
Last ready, here's a 3-1 to Ulander. Swung on and grounded to Stargell at first base on two hops, and Willie makes the play unassisted for the second out. So Ulander rolls out, and up comes Pete Rose, who grounded out in the first, and then hit a bizarre double off the seam where the AstroTurf meets the dirt in the first base sliding box in the third. That drove in a run. Two out, base is empty. Pirates leading 3-2. Hebner and Chano at third, the outfield playing straight away. Glass winds, pitch to Rose. He takes low, ball one, 1-0. Pittsburgh, 3 runs, 7 hits, no errors. Cincinnati, 2 runs, 3 hits, and 1 error. 1-0 to Rose. Pete looks at the strike, and the count is even. 1-1. Rose has already set a record for most hits in a championship series. He has 9 in the 5 games. He is 9-for-19. 1-1 pitch is a strike on the inside corner, a slider in the count 1-2. Glass standing on the first base side of the rubber into his windup. Here's a 1-2 pitch on the way. Rose swings and misses strike 3. So Glass gives up the homer and then sets down Cheney, Ulander, and Rose. And the Reds settle for a run, 1 hit, nobody left on. At the end of 5, Pittsburgh 3, Cincinnati 2.
Tournament favorite Lee Trevino quit practice today in England and was confined to bed under doctor's orders on the eve of the $62,500 Piccadilly World Match Play Golf Championship at Wentworth, England. Now, his manager said that the doctors say that Lee has a respiratory virus and is to stay in bed. The chances of playing are 80%. Trevino, runner-up in 1970, was installed as a 5-2 favorite for the 3-day man-to-man event, which has a top-class selected 8-man field from the USA, Great Britain, Australia, and South Africa. Lee was drawn against fellow American Doug Sanders, also far from fully fit, and a man making his first appearance in the unique event. Sanders, a 12-1 bet, has had injections for muscle spasms in his shoulder and complained today of a stomach upset. Second favorite, 11-4 today, in today's odds, was reigning champion Gary Player of South Africa.
This is Al Michaels with Joe Nuxall. The National League pennant at stake, Game 5 Championship Series in Cincinnati. The Pirates lead the Reds 3-2. The new Cincinnati pitcher is left-hander Tom Hall, 10-1 this season, 8 saves. A 2.61 earned run average, and he goes to work on Willie Stargell, Manny Sandin, and Rich Hebner. Hall making his second appearance in the championship series. He was one of the big heroes for the Reds Sunday as the Reds even the series at a game each. Hall in relief worked 4 1/3 innings. He gave up 1 run, 2 hits, and was the winning pitcher. Willie Stargell popped out and fouled out. He's 0-for-2 today, and he's 1-for-14 in the series. Tommy Hall into his windup, and the pitch to Stargell misses low in the dirt. Ball one. 1-0. The Pirates got 2 in the second. The Reds came back with 1 in the third. The Pirates got 1 in the fourth. The Reds tied or came within 1 in the fifth on the homer by Geronimo to make it 3-2, and that's the way it stands right now. Left-hander working on left-hander. Hall to the plate. Stargell swings and foul tips it into Bench's glove. 1-1. Field swung well over to it right. Minky is a good 40 feet off the line at third base. Here's a 1-1 pitch. Stargell fouls it back and the count 1-2. On deck is Manny Sandin, and then we'll see Richie Hebner. It's been Sandin, Hebner, and Cash doing all the damage today. All ready. Here's a 1-2 pitch to Stargell, missing outside. Ball 2. 2-2. Dovitz started. Bourbon in the fourth. Pedro worked through the fifth, and now Tommy Hall, picked up by the Reds from Minnesota, and the deal is in Wayne Granger to the Twins. Here's a 2-2 to Stargell, missing outside and low, ball three, and the count is full. Hall goes to his cap and to the rosin bag. Tommy from Riverside, California, into his windup, and the 3-2 to Stargell is swung on and grounded foul outside first. Count holding. Hall, 6 feet even, weighs 155. They call him the Blade, born in Thomasville, North Carolina, now living in Riverside. He's 24 years old. 3-2 to Stargell, swung on and missed. Stargell has to be talking to himself. He was hitless in the championship series against San Francisco last year. Had a bad month of September this year after a great season to that point. And here in the championship series, he's 1-for-15. Here is Manny Sanguin, who has twice singled and twice scored. So the free swinger from Panama, 2-for-2 and 5-for-14 during the playoffs. Reds playing him around to it right. By Hall, and the pitch to Sanguin misses up and in, ball one. Pirates three, Reds two, one out, bases empty, top of the sixth. Hall, feet barely apart on the rubber, rocks to his windup. 1-0 pitch is fouled back. 1-1. On deck is Richie Hebner. Here's a 1-1 pitch, fouled back, and the count 1-2. Here's the wind, and the 1-2 pitch to Sandine, and it's swung on and fouled back. One ball, two strikes on Sandin with one out and the bases empty. If you joined us late, we had a 1 hour, 28 minute rain delay before the start of the game. Here's the 1-2 pitch on the way, inside, backing him away. Slider missing, 2-2. Hall hunches over, has the sign. 2-2 to Sandin, is swung on a high fly ball to left field. Pete Rose coming over, losing his cap, but staying with it, makes the catch. Two down. Richie Hebner coming up. Hebner faced Gullit twice, doubled and singled in two trips, so again he faces a left-hander. And Richie against left-handers and right-handers, which was really odd because when he first came up, they platooned him. He played against right-handers only. Open stance, he swings, hits a ground ball right side. Morgan fields, flips to Perez, covering, side retires. The Pittsburgh Pirates go down 1-2-3, Bourbon and Hall between them and set down 8 in a row. And at the end of 5 and a half, Pirates 3, Reds 2.
Heavy rain and cold weather in Budapest have not hampered interest in the Davis Cup tennis final to be played between the USA and Romania. Tickets are at a premium in the Romanian capital. The matches will get underway on Friday. Both teams have been forced to practice indoor on clay courts, similar to the ones to be used in the best-of-five series. But Wednesday, both teams got in a short outdoor session as the weather cleared up somewhat. Romania's lineup is set with Ilina Spazi and Ian Tirac scheduled to play two singles matches each, and in the doubles. Stan Smith is scheduled to play in two singles matches and in the doubles with Eric Van Dillen. It will be either Tom Gorman or Harold Solomon for the other singles assignment. Well, the Pittsburgh-Cincinnati game finally got underway an hour and 28 minutes late.
And this is do or die day at Riverfront Stadium in Cincinnati. We go to the home six. The Reds need a run or two to get back in this ball game.
If the World Series is played at Riverfront, $8 reserve seats go on sale immediately after today's game. The ticket sale will be from the west ticket area of Riverfront. Some 8,000 reserve seats at $8 for each of the games go on sale at the same time, and the ticket office would open again tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock. Bottom of the sixth inning, Joe Morgan, Bobby Tolan, and Johnny Bench. With the Pirates leading 3-2, Steve Blass ready to work on Morgan. And his first pitch is a fastball hit in the air to right center field. Roberto Clemente drifting in, waiting underneath, and makes the basket catch for the first out. One pitch, one away. Blass has set down four straight, nine of the last ten. The only man to get on was Geronimo, who homered. So Morgan out for the third time today. One away, Bobby Tolan the batter. Tolan is grounded out twice. Bobby hit 283 during the year. The pitch is a strike as he bluffs him on, 0-1. Pittsburgh, three runs, seven hits, and no errors. Cincinnati, two runs, three hits, and one error. Blass back to the plate with a change over for a strike, 0-2. Blass with fine control today, one walk, four strikeouts, been ahead on almost everybody. Lines 0-2 to Tolan. Bobby hits a broken bat number on one hop to catch. Dave throws to first and is two down. Johnny Bench the batter. Bench popped out in the second, grounded out in the fourth. For the first time today, we can see blue sky. Is that a silver lining up there, Nux? Waiting at the plate with two down. The pitch is swung on, lined sharply off the glove of Alley and out into shallow center field. Bench around first and he'll hold as Alley comes up with the ball and gets it back in. It'll be a base hit for Bench off the glove of the shortstop. Four hits for the Reds, and up comes Tony Perez, who has struck out twice. Perez in the series is 3-for-18. Tony had a hit in four trips against Blass. Saturday, he struck out his last time up. He has struck out his first two times today, so Blass has struck Perez out three times in a row. Bench the tying run at first base. Two down, bottom of the sixth. Pirates leading 3-2. Bench held by Stargell. The stretch by Blass and the pitch on the way. Perez chops it foul at home plate, 0-1. Earlier today, the Detroit Tigers beat the Oakland A's 4-3. They'll play for the pennant in the American League tomorrow. In that game, the A's got two in the top of the 11th, and the Tigers came back with three. Here's a strike, one pitch on the way. Swung on, hit in the air to deep right center field. Clemente going back, has a play, and makes the catch on the warning track. So Perez would drive to deep right center, but Clemente back to make the catch, and the Reds out of the six. No runs are hit, one left at the end of six. Pittsburgh, three. Cincinnati, too.
Well, the Cincinnati Reds, of course, brag about their fine hitting and base running, but Bucks manager Bill Verdon thinks he has the best pitching staff.
Well, I said earlier in the year that I wouldn't trade our staff for anybody's in baseball, and I still mean that, and I'll stick by that, and I think the performance they've put forth all year has shown that I wasn't too far wrong, because I think our long suit is pitching. They can talk about the hitting all they want to, and our hitting is good, but our pitchers have done the job that nobody else could do in baseball.
Bucks manager Bill Verdon and his fine pitching staff. Steve Blass, the starting pitcher, still in there. He's the one that pitched that first game back last Saturday. Seems like a long time ago. Don Gullett no longer around, as Borvin came on in the fourth inning to get the Cincinnati Reds out of trouble when Pittsburgh scored one of their runs. But now we go to the top of the seventh, and the Pirates on top, 3-2.
Seventh inning, game moving along quickly. It's 3-2 Pirates, and for more play-by-play, here again is Joe Nuxall.
All right, Al. Well, a lot of tension building here at Riverfront Stadium. Everybody's jumping around. For the Pirates in the seventh, it'll be Dave Cash, Gene Alley, and pitcher Steve Blass. Cash is 2-for-2 and has driven in two of the Pirates' three runs. He's singled twice. Tom Wall, third pitcher, delivers to Cash up high, a ball. Don Gullett started for the Reds, worked three innings, allowed six hits, and all three of the runs off Gullett, all earned runs. Pedro Bourbon, two innings. Here's the 1-0. Cash takes high and outside. It's two balls, no strike. Bourbon working two innings, allowing one hit and striking out one. All coming on in the sixth. 3-2, Pittsburgh lead. Seventh inning. 2-0 the count to Dave Cash. Hall delivers. Cash takes a strike, a fastball, and it's 2-1. Hall into the windup, his 2-1 delivery. Cash swings on it and pops it into left field. Pete Rose moving a couple of steps to his left, waits, makes the catch, one away. One down, and that brings up Gene Alley, the Pirate shortstop. The alley is 0-2. Is it a fly ball to center and 1-2 right field, and there's two times the plate. Moving to the on-deck circle, pitcher Steve Blatt. All works. The alley swings and fouls into the mid of Johnny Bench. 0-1. Pirates getting two runs in the second inning. Picking up one more in the fourth. The 0-1 delivery from Hall. Alley takes a breaking ball at the knees. Ball is strike two. One out, the base is empty. Hall leaning forward. Gets the sign. And the 0-2. That's ball. Gets the inside corner. Ball strike three. So Hall gets his second strikeout. Two away here in the seventh, and it brings pitcher Steve Blass to the plate. Blass, 0-2 in the second inning, trying to bunt on the third strike, fouled it, a strikeout, and then the fourth inning, he helped things along by grounding into a double play. Hall winds and delivers the first pitch to Blass, swung on and pulled foul along the left field line. 0-1 to count. The Pirates have had seven hits in the game. The Reds, four. Now the 0-1. Blast takes up high, a fastball. It's even at a ball of strike. The season wound up with 10 victories and one loss. 1-1 delivery. He swung on and missed a carry to 22. Tom Hall doing a great job for the Reds this year, coming over to Cincinnati from the Minnesota Twins in a trade for right-handed reliever Wayne Granger. Clay Carroll throwing down in the Reds' bullpen. Here's the 1-2. Swung on and missed, and that takes care of the Pirates here in the seventh as Hall gets two strikeouts. Nothing across for Pittsburgh in inning number seven, and at the middle of the seventh inning in the final of the championship series, it's the Pirates 3, the Reds 2.
The World Hockey Association will launch its first season tonight with two games on tap, Alberta at Ottawa and Quebec at Cleveland. Now, the National Hockey League has a number of games set, and to be exact, they have seven. Montreal's at Toronto, Vancouver at New York against the Rangers, the Boston Bruins at Detroit, Los Angeles will be in Buffalo, Atlanta at Chicago, Pittsburgh at St. Louis, and California at Minnesota. I think we mentioned the NBA has a few games, Boston at Detroit, Seattle at Philadelphia, and Los Angeles plays a new Kansas City Omaha team in Omaha, Nebraska. The American Basketball Association gets underway with their season Thursday night. Well, the time's kind of running out for the Cincinnati Reds, but we have another cliffhanger like we had earlier on AFRTS, the American League game, won by Detroit to even things up at two games apiece. Cincinnati has three more times up, though, to Pittsburgh, two, and they only trail by one run. Let's see what happens.
For the Reds, in the bottom half of the seventh inning, Dennis Menke, Cesar Geronimo, Darryl Chaney. Menke, 0-1. He walked back in the second inning. In the fourth inning, he grounded too short. Well, here we go in the seventh with the Reds at the plate. They've got four hits off Steve Blass. Two of them extra bases. Pete Rose had a bat hop double in the third inning, and then Geronimo lined a home run over the right field fence in the fifth. Last is ready with his first pitch to Menke outside with a slider. 1-0. We'll have to put some change on my partner, Al Michaels. Looks like a wildcat pacing back and forth in here. So 1-0, Menke takes high. It's 2 balls, no strike. Glass has walked just one, and the one walk is gone to Dennis Menke in the second inning. Geronimo on deck. Clay Carroll throwing in the Cincinnati bullpen. 2 balls, no strikes to count. Pirates leading 3-2. Glass delivers. Menke swings and hits it deep to left, but I don't think it's going to be enough. Sent it in the middle of the warning track, waiting, makes the catch. A one away, and we pause for station identification. This. Joe Knoxall with Al Michaels at Riverfront Stadium in Cincinnati. The Pirates leading 3-2. First pitch to Geronimo is fouled out of play. Geronimo, 1-for-2, a home run in the fifth inning. Pirates scoring 2 in the second, 1 in the fourth. The Reds getting their runs, 1 in the third, 1 in the fifth. The outfield shaded a bit to right for Geronimo. Glass delivers, fastball outside, it's 1-1. Dale Cheney waits on deck. Glass lines and delivers. Geronimo swings and bounces it fair along the first baseline, grabbed by Stargell and then threw away. Stargell taking the play unassisted. Two out, and Darrell Cheney steps in. Cheney is 1-for-2. He singled in the third inning. Moved to second on a sacrifice by Gullett and scored on the bad bounce double by Pete Rose. Two away, the base is empty. Glass into the windup. His first pitch to Cheney swung on and missed. A breaking ball low and inside. 0-1. Tommy Hall on deck, but should Cheney get on? No doubt about a pinch hitter. Here's the 0-1. Darrell takes a strike, and it's 0-2. Glass bringing a slider over the outside corner. To the count. Glass into the wind and his 0-2 delivery. Swung on and bounced back to the mound. Reaching above his head as Glass has it. Throws on to Stargell and the Reds are out 1-2-3. In the seventh inning, nothing across. And after seven here at Riverfront, it remains the Pirates 3, the Reds 2.
Turning to a little bit of news about football, when the NFL training season started, the Dallas Cowboys had 3 players named Thomas on the roster. Dwayne Thomas and Isaac Thomas were traded, leaving only Bill Thomas. But the number one draft choice was placed on taxi squad until he completely recovered from a shoulder operation. The Boston College graduate says he is now set to go. He is ready to be activated and hopes the Cowboys will take care of that detail very shortly. Bob Thomas appears to be a cinch to break one record at Notre Dame. He has kicked 11 field goals thus far. The school record of 14 is held by Scott Hempel. Thomas is only a junior. Last year, he led the Fighting Irish in scoring with 36 points on 21 conversions and 5 field goals. This year, Thomas again leads the scorers with 28 points on 10 conversions and 6 field goals. We go to the eighth inning now with the Pirates coming up again, and they lead by 1.
7 inning totals. Pittsburgh, 3 runs, 7 hits, and no errors. The Reds, 2 runs, 4 hits, and 1 error. The top of the Pirate lineup due up in the 8th inning. Back with the action. Now, Michael.
All right, next couple of great playoff games today. In the American League, Oakland looked like they had the pennant wrapped up. They scored 2 in the 11th. Tigers came back with 3 to send the series to a 5th game tomorrow for all the marbles. This one here today for all the marbles. It's 3-2 Pirates. 8th inning. Rennie Stennett will lead off. Then we'll see Al Oliver and Roberto Clemente. And this will be Tommy Hall's last inning. He's due to lead off in the bottom of the 8th. If I had a guess, I would say Joe Haig will bat for him and then Rose and Morgan in the bottom of the 8th. Rennie Stennett, fly to right, grounded to third, grounded to first, 0 for 3, 5 for 20 in the series. Hall into his windup, and comes to the plate, fastball outside, ball one. Hall has faced six men, retired them all, struck out three. The last 11 Pirates in a row have gone down at the hands of Bourbon and Hall. 1-0 to Stennett, just off the plate outside, ball two, 2-0. Oliver on deck. Outfield around toward right. The wind and the 2-0 pitch on the way is low, ball three. 3-0 the count. The Pirates have not had a walk today. Already, here's a 3-0 offering in first strike, and it's 3-1. Stennett with his best move toward first, but Donatelli says not by any means. 3-1. The wind, and the pitcher swung on and grounded into left field for a base hit. So Rennie Stennett leads off with a single here in the eighth inning, the first Pirate hit since back in the fourth, when Dave Cash singled a drive in Pittsburgh's third run. Up comes Al Oliver. Oliver got off to a great start in the series. He's 0 for 3 today, and he does not have a hit in his last seven times up. 0 for 4 yesterday, left-hand batter. Mickey in shallow at third. The stretch and the pitch. Oliver bunts to the right of the plate, fielded by Bench. He has to go to first for the out, and down to second goes Stennett. So the Pirates sacrifice 2-4 as Rennie Stennett advances to second. And up comes Roberto Clemente, who singled in the first, flied out in the third, struck out in the fifth. This is the first time he's faced Tommy Hall today. Facing Hall on Sunday, he flied out in his only appearance. They're going to walk him intentionally. So the Reds are going to walk Clemente to get to Stargell, who they've been able to handle with relative ease in this series. Willie will come up 1 for 15, and the Reds don't want to fool around with Roberto. Take their chances with the left-hand batter. Stargell coming up. No activity in the bullpen for the Reds. Hall has to get out of the inning. Sparky doesn't want to bring Carroll in because he's got a hit for the pitcher leading off in the bottom of the eighth. So Hall has to get out of it by himself. The Pirates have their first activity now of the day. Dave Justy is going down to heat up. Stargell, 0 for 3 today, popped out, fouled out, struck out, 1 for 15 in the series, left-hand batter. Hall is set, a glance at second, pitch to Stargell is inside, ball one. 1-0. Stennett at second, Clemente at first, one out in the eighth inning, 3-2 Pittsburgh. Already, back to the plate he comes, Stargell swings and misses, 1-1. On deck is Sam Guillen. Stargell hit 248 against left-handers this year. However, he did have 10 home runs off lefties. Hit 23 off right-handers. All back of the plate, 1-1. Stargell takes just outside. Ball two, 2-1. Carroll is now throwing again in the Cincinnati bullpen. At the belt, a glance at second, 2-1 pitch to Stargell, swung out and missed, 2-2. Two on, one out, eighth inning, Pirates on top, 3-2. 2-2 the count on Stargell. All looking in. Tommy with a sign. Here's a stretch. 2-2 pitch. Got him looking. Ball strike three. Jammed him with a fastball when it looked like Stargell expected something out over the plate. is his fourth strikeout. There's two down now in the eighth inning. And the batter is Manny Sandin, who has singled twice and flied out.
Now, that was a pretty good operation by Tom Hall. He throws in four straight breaking balls and throws that good fastball in on him. And I think Willie, as you said, is looking for a breaking ball one more time.
The attendance today is 41,867. Manny Sandin. He is 5-for-15 in the series. Right-hand batter. All set and delivers, and Sandin swings, pops it in the air, and foul ground off to the right. I don't think it's playable. Bench comes to the dugout, and it's back at about the fourth row. 0-1. Clay Carroll throwing in the red pen, and loosening up next to him is shortstop Dave Concepcion, who quite logically could be used as a pinch runner. If Joe Haig were to lead off and get on, I'm sure Concepcion would go out to run for him, either Concepcion or Foster. One one count. All is set. And the strike one pitch to Sandin. Swung on and missed. He takes a very high fastball, 0-2. The other Pirates fan, Ramon Hernandez, now going down to throw. All right. Pitch to Sandin just outside. Ball one, 1-2. The Pirates, two runs in the second. The Reds got a run in the third. The Pirates, one in the fourth. The Reds, one in the fifth. It is 3-2 Pittsburgh in the eighth inning. The sign from bench, the stretch, 1-2 pitch on the way, swung on, foul back, Sandin hanging in. Stennett, who led off with a single, is at second. Clemente, who has walked intentionally, on at first. All is set. 1-2 pitch on the way. Swung on, a ground ball to Morgan at second. Tough hop, but he stays with it. Throws and gets in. Perez had it stretched all the way up. Argument at first base, and Burden is coming out. But I believe the replay will show that Sandin was out on a nice play by Morgan and a nice play by Perez. So Sandin gone, and down go the Pirates in the eighth. No runs a hit. They leave two at the end of 7.5. Pittsburgh 3, Cincinnati 2.
Well, they're talking about moving again, expansion moves in the major leagues, and two baseball teams are seriously considering moving to the city of New Orleans within the next 2 or 3 years. This is according to Louisiana Superdome director Ben Levy. Levy said that two club owners have told him they were ready to move to the giant sports arena being erected in New Orleans. But he said the club owners were not discussing the matter publicly for fear of dwindling attendance at games in their current homestand. The $129.5 million multi-purpose arena will be the largest such facility in the world. The New York Times said that the structure will make all other stadiums in existence as obsolete as Rome's Colosseum. Completion date is expected during late summer of 1974. It will accommodate 56,600 fans for baseball contests.
Of the eighth inning, Bill Verdon put up a mild beef at first base on the play that ended the top of the eighth inning. I think the television replay left no doubt about it. Sandin was out. Morgan to Perez. In the bullpen, Dave Justy, a right-hander. Ramon Hernandez, a left-hander. In the Reds bullpen, right-hander Clay Carroll. He will pitch the ninth inning. Paul is coming out for a pinch hitter. Joe Haig, acquired from the Cardinals in May, and a deal has sent Bernie Carbo to St. Louis. Haig this year batted 243. 7 home runs, 31 runs batted in. So Hall is out. He goes 3 innings, no runs a hit. 1 intentional walk, 4 strikeouts, his second fine effort. Joe Haig, left-hand batter, takes a changeup in the dirt, ball 1. 1-0. It'll be Haig, then the top of the order, Pete Rose, then Joe Morgan. Steve Lass has given up 4 hits, in seven innings. He has walked one, struck out four. Here's a 1-0 pitch on the way. Change, very high, ball two, 2-0. Dave Concepcion and George Foster, I can see them both in the dugout. Either one ready to pinch run if Hay gets on. Here's Glasser's 2-0 pitch, way outside, ball three. 3-0 the count. Sandin calls time and goes to the mound. Oh, boy. I don't have to over-dramatize anything. Just sit here and call it ball one, strike one. Don't even have to use an adjective. I think you can feel what's going on. 3-0 the count. Glass ready, and a pitch, a strike. 3-1. All right, now does he get the hit sign or the take sign? What is it? Grammar's flashing sign. Bob Robertson now playing first base for the Bucs. Stargell has come out. Glass ready. And a 3-1 to Haig is low, ball four. So the tying run is at first base, and Dave Concepcion will run for Haig. And Hernandez. Glass will stay in. Pete Rose, the batter. So the top of the order coming up for the Reds. Pete Rose, an all-time championship series record. He has 9 hits.
You have to go back to yesterday and remember that Johnny Bench stole 2 bases on Manny Sanguin, although Steve Glass has one of the best moves in the league for a right-hander. Dave Concepcion has stolen 13 bases and 18 tries. What will happen?
We'll see now. Rose waits to the plate. The pitch on the way. Concepcion goes, and Rose fouls it back to the red plate, hit and run, and Pete fouls it off, 0-1. Rose today grounded out in the first, doubled in the third, struck out in the fifth. He is 9-for-20 in the championship series. Morgan on deck. Pirates 3, Reds 2, bottom of the 8th inning. Concepcion at first base and nobody out. Ebner in very shallow at third base. Crowd going wild. Here's the stretch. Concepcion does not go. Rose bunts to Ebner at third. Ritchie looks to first, throws to first, gets him there. Concepcion goes to second. So Cash covers. The play goes 5-4 on the sacrifice. The Reds have the tying run at second. Morgan the batter, Burden coming out, so that will do it for Blast. Now, they'll probably bring in the left-hander Ramon Hernandez. Hernandez is very tough against left-handed hitters, but we go back to Sunday when Hernandez faced Morgan. Joe hit a home run. So Morgan will be coming up. Jesse and Hernandez in the bullpen. And the left-hander will come in. It'll be Ramon Hernandez. So Steve Blass goes 7 1/3 inning. He leaves the game. He can win it or have nothing to do with it. He cannot lose it. While the pitcher comes in, Dave Concepcion and Alex Gramish have a conference. Gramish, the Red third base coach. And Gramish, I'm sure, is going through every possibility with Concepcion on how to run the bases right now.
Down there checking right now. Davey is over there checking the condition of the area around third base, making sure that the footing is right and everything. And of course, everything plays a part in this ball game today. The turf being wet, a ball hitting the hole could get through. The sliding areas are not wet, they're a bit damp, I guess I could put it that way, a bit damp. They have put a lot of compound at third base in particular, so apparently that's the wettest of the four bases. So, here we go. Ramon Hernandez. I tell you, this guy has got a herky-jerky delivery, and he's tough to hit off of. And did a great job for the Pirates. But as you say, Morgan hit a home run off of him in Pittsburgh.
Here's a man who appeared in 53 games this season and didn't lose a game. He was 5-0, a 1.67 earned run average. He worked 70 innings, allowed 50 hits, walked 22, and struck out 47. So he is brought in to face Morgan, and the next batter is a left-handed hitter, Tolan, then Bench, and by that time, if Hernandez doesn't have it, then Verdon goes to the bullpen again and brings in the ace, Jussie. Pittsburgh leading, 3-2, Joe Morgan the batter. Morgan is 0-3 today. He's fly to center, grounded out, fly to right. 5-18 in the championship series. Concepcion at second base. Off to a cautious lead. Morgan, a 292 hitter during the year. The outfield deep and around towards right. Robertson guarding the line at first. Hedner guards the line at third. Hernandez set. First pitch to Morgan. Fastball for a strike. 0-1. Hernandez, originally signed by the Pirates and let go, bounced around, went to Mexico, picked up last year, spent some time in the minors, called up during the year, and had a great season in 72 of the Bucs. The stretch, the strike one pitch on the way. Breaking ball, a ground ball to Dave Sanchez at second. He drops it, picks it up, throws, and gets him. And Concepcion goes to third. Oh, what a play at first base, and they call him out. So they get Morgan. As Sanchez drops the ball, booted it, still had time to pick it up. As he kept it in front of him and threw to first in time to get Morgan. And boy, is the replay close. But I think he got him. So there's two down and the tying run is at third and the batter is Bobby Tolan. Tolan has hit the ball three times today, all three times on the ground. He's grounded out on three occasions. He's 5-for-20. In the series, left-hander against left-hander. Hernandez through his windup, and the pitch to Tolan is in the dirt and blocked by Sanguin to save a wild pitch. 1-0. Bench on deck. Concepcion at third. Two down. Bottom of the eighth. Here's the 1-0 pitch on the way. Swung on, fouled back, and it's 1-1. Hedner in shallow at third. Robertson deep at first. Here's a 1-1 pitch to Tolan. Bobby swings and misses, and it's 1-2. Actually, just got a piece of it. Foul tipped it in and out of Sandian's glove. Bench on deck. A ball, two strikes to count. Hedner backing up at third. Tolan waiting. Hernandez working from a windup to his motion. 1-2 on the way, breaking ball low. Ball two, 2-2. Pittsburgh, 3 runs, 8 hits and no errors. Cincinnati, 2 runs, 4 hits, 1 error. Hernandez winds. 2-2 to Tolan. Bobby swings and misses, strike 3. So Hernandez comes on and does the job. And the Reds leave the tying run at third base in the eighth inning. No runs, no hits. One man left on. We go to the ninth with the score. Pittsburgh 3, Cincinnati 2.
Another baseball manager has gotten the axe today. The California Angels have announced that they have fired manager Del Rice and replaced him with former college coach Bobby Winkles. Winkles, 42, joined the Angels as a coach early this year after a successful career as coach at Arizona State, where he won 3 national championships. General Manager Harry Dalton announced the changes at an Anaheim Stadium news conference just a while ago. Dalton himself was a newcomer with the Angels this season, coming to Anaheim from the Baltimore Orioles, where he was Director of Player Personnel. Winkles was signed to a 1-year contract at an undisclosed salary. Dalton said Rice would be welcome to remain in the Angel organization if he wishes. Rice was not present at the announcement. Winkles, an inspirational type, never played baseball in the majors. An infielder, he spent 5 years in the Chicago White Sox organization.
Al Michaels, along with Joe Nuxall, ninth inning, 3-2 Pittsburgh. Clay Cowell, the new pitcher for the Reds, he'll face Rich Hedner Dave Cash, and Gene Alley. Richie Hebner, left-hand batter, hits a curve in the air and foul ground off to the left. Dennis Minkey might have a play, comes to the edge of the Pirate dugout and takes it in. One away. Hebner is gone. Dave Cash, the batter. He has singled twice and flied out. Dave Justy had come back to the Pirate dugout. He will start to warm up again in the Pittsburgh bullpen. If you're Bill Verdon, what do you do in the ninth inning? Do you leave the left-hander in to face bench Perez and Mankey, or do you bring Justy in right away and let him pitch the ninth? That's the decision he's got to make. In the red pen, it is Jack filling. It's Bill McLaughlin loosening up. Cash hits a one-hopper to Mankey at third and throws him out, and it's two down. Tim McLaughlin loosening up in the red pen. Two down, Gene Alley the batter. Alley is 0 for 3. Flied out twice and struck out. He's 0 for 15 in the series. Pirates on top, 3-2. Clay Carroll, pitcher number 4. Great relief work turned in by the Reds today. Pitch on the way to Alley is fouled back. 0-1. Nobody out on deck for the Pirates. Hernandez is due to bat next. Justy throwing in the pen. Carroll taking the sign from bench. Here's the strike one pitch on the way. Curve outside. Ball one. 1-1. Nelson Bryles is throwing in the Pirate pen also. Curve outside. Ball two. 2-1. Bryles and Justy. Here's a 2-1 pitch on the way. Swung on a slow chopper to third. Minkey fields on the second hop. Throws and gets it. So a 1-2-3 inning. The Pirates out in order. And this place will go bananas right now because the Reds are coming up in the bottom of the ninth inning with the score. Pittsburgh 3, Cincinnati 2.
Well, in case you didn't miss the exciting American League playoff game today at Tiger Stadium, and one was on AFRTS, the series is now even at 2-up. And, of course, Thursday will tell who will face the National League winner here in this game we're broadcasting right now, either Pittsburgh or Cincinnati. The Tigers, in one of baseball's more amazing comebacks, beat the Oakland A's 4-3 in 10 frames. Also tied the American League playoffs, as he mentioned, at 2 games apiece. After Oakland broke a tie with 2 runs in the top half of the 10th, Detroit rallied for 3 runs in the bottom of the inning to stay alive in the playoffs. Jim Northrup singled home the winning run after the tying run scored on a bases-loaded walk. Playoff goes to a 5th game in the siding contest tomorrow. And again, played in Detroit. For the 2nd day in a row, the A's missed a chance to gain to win the playoff and the pennant. They could have done it with a victory on Tuesday. With their 2 runs at the top of the 10th, it appeared they would do it on Wednesday. But then Matty Alou led off with a double. Ted Kubiak singled home the 2nd run. Then the Tigers came to bat. And as we mentioned, they did it as Jim Northrup with the bases loaded, with the infield and outfield drawn in by Oakland manager Dick Williams, hit the ball over the right fielder's head up against the fence. Of course, it goes as a single. The winning run coming in from 3rd base, and that's all she wrote. Final again, the Detroit Tigers 4 and the Oakland A's 3. Well, Johnny Bench will lead things off for Cincinnati, their final hopes for 1972, and they must do it in this final inning against the Cincinnati Reds. Bourbon pitching, relieving Gallette in the 4th. Steve Blass starting for Pittsburgh. Ramon Hernandez came on in the 8th. Let's go back to Cincinnati now, Michaels.
And he was going for the down. 0-1. Bench has popped out, grounded out, singled. 1-for-3, 5-for-17 in the series. Justy ready, back he comes. Bench takes a slider outside. Ball one, 1-1. Outfield deep and around toward left. 3-8-0, the totals for the Pirates. 2-4-1 for the Reds. Justy winds, and the 1-1 pitch to Bench is swung on and missed. Again, a full rip on a sinker. 1-2. Justy sinking fastball, slider, palm ball. Good control. Tony Perez on deck. Justy bends in, takes the sign. The right-hander winds. And the 1-2 pitch to bench. Johnny swings and drills it a mile, but foul. Boy, he had all of that one, but foul by plenty. Hit it up into the red seat, the upper deck. 2. The wine. And a pitch to bench. Chains hit in the air to deep right field. Back goes Clemente. It's a fan. He
one to right. The game is tied. Here's Perez. Just into the play. Perez swings. Base hit to center field. The pennant is at first base with nobody out. Dennis Menke is the batter. Alex Grammis, the third base coach, will talk to him. George Foster is coming out to run for Perez. Johnny Bench, a home run to right field. Bill Gordon going to the mound. He's the coolest man in the ballpark right now. Everybody, 41,867, standing up, watching another incredible game in this championship series, which will be remembered for a long time. Boy, it's amazing when you think about it. 1951, you went right down to the last game. Thompson hit the home run to win it for the Giants. 62, they went down to the last game. They went to the ninth inning. The Giants got 4 to beat the Dodgers. And now the Reds try to win it tonight. Dusty will stay in. Foster at first base. He is the pennant-winning run. Dennis Menke, the batter, is deafening in here. Hebner ready to charge from third. Menke around the bunt, takes high. Ball one. 1-0. On deck is Geronimo. Red 3. Pirates 3. Nobody out. Bottom of the ninth inning. Everybody standing. Everybody. Dusty is set. Menke around a bunt. Foul tipped it into the glove of Sandin for a strike. The pitch up and in, and he tried to back away. 1-1. Foster at first base. Foster is lead. Jesse set, and a 1-1 pitch. Menke bunt foul. Back to the screen. 1-2. So now two strikes on Menke. And he looks down at Alex Grammis, the third base coach for the time. Justin, reading Sandin. Walks off his lead at first. 1-2 pitch, outside, ball two. 2-2. We go to a 10th inning. The Pirates have Justy due to lead off, then Bennett and Oliver. Jim McLaughlin is throwing in the Reds' fan. Justy is set. Here's the 2-2 pitch to Menke. Low, ball three. Full count. Now, do the Reds start Foster? Let's take a look at Menke's statistics as Sandin. This is Justy. Menke struck out 76 times this year, 447 trips to the plate. Relatively high average. So do you risk it? Do you have Foster go and risk Menke striking out? Let's see. 3-2 the count. Time is called. Menke backs out. Now Denny climbs in. Here's the stretch. Foster goes. Menke fouls it straight back. Sending Foster. We'll try to get a station break in a minute. Three and two the count. And time is called out. Jesse backs off the road.
first base. Foster diving back in just to make sure. Duffy, ready to work again. Again, a throw to first. Foster back. Bob Robertson now playing first base. Gargle is out of the game. Moose and Biles in the Pirate bullpen. Duffy is set. Foster goes. 3-2 pitch. Line foul into the Pirate bullpen. Domenici got good wood. Line to foul, and we pause for station identification. Ball count. Duffy set. 3-2 pitch. Foster goes. Menke gets a... the batter. The Reds, 3 runs, 7 hits, and 1 error. The Pirates, 3 runs, 8 hits, and no errors. Dave Dance coming to the mound. To the Pirates, out in front from the second inning on. They led 2-0 in the second. The Reds got a run in the third. The Pirates picked up one in the fourth. The Reds got one in the fifth. It stayed that way. It was 3-2. Here in the ninth, Johnny Bench, an opposite field home run. Tony Perez, a single to center. Dennis Menke, a single to left. The pinch runner, George Foster, who is the pennant, is at second base. Nobody out. Geronimo, the batter. The Pirates expect him to bunt. Duffy, ready. Geronimo, around a bunt, takes very high. Ball one. Cheney on deck. 1-0 the count. Time is called now. As Sandin goes to the mound, Grammett goes to talk to Foster. Seeing the way the Pirates played it, Robertson charging in, Hebner charging in that time with Alley, the shortstop, going over to cover third. Red 3, Pirates 3, bottom of the ninth. Foster at second, Menke at first. Nobody out. Geronimo is waiting at the plate. Duffy with a time. Here's the stretch. 1-0. Geronimo takes high. Ball 2. 2-0. Here comes Burden. And so he's going to make a change here. He's got Riles. And he has Moose in the bullpen. It's 2-0 on Geronimo. I know for those of you on the Reds Baseball Network, I do not have to do any apologizing at all. For those of you who have picked us up around the country, we appreciate the fact that we were selected to broadcast the game around the country, and if there's a little partiality being shown, I think you can understand why. That's all for Justy, and Bob Moose will come on. Bob Moose is making his second appearance in this series. He was a starting pitcher on Sunday and did not get anybody out. He gave up a single to Rose, a single to Morgan, a double to Tolan, a double to Bench, a double to Perez. So he comes in a spot where he has to face Geronimo with a count 2-0. Foster, who is the pennant winning run at second base, Dennis Menke on at first. Grammett even talks to Menke. And now he's going to go out and check with Foster. Oh, boy. Unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable. Since we do all the Reds games and saw all of Bench's home runs, I would have to go back in the book to find out to which field he hit every home run. But of his 40, I would guess, just as an estimate, that he hit 32 to left field, I'd say maybe 6 or 7 to center, and 1 or 2 to right. His home run here came to right field with 2 strikes. The man has incredible power. He took 2 vicious cuts. He had 2 strikes. He took another cut. He hit the ball into the upper deck here, which is a jolt, even though it was fouled by plenty. Then he teed off and hit a ball over the right center field fence. That tied the game.
Perez single to center. Foster went in a run for him. Menke then single to left. And Cesar Geronimo the batter. Geronimo has twice rounded the first, and he hit a home run in the fifth inning to get the Reds to within one. So Bob Moose, who was 13-10 this season, with a 2.9 earned run average, appeared only one time this season in relief, and it was against the Reds, and he picked up a save. So here he is in relief. Robertson ready to charge in from first. Hebner staying back at third. We'll see how the Pirates defend it. Geronimo up in a bunch situation, but he may be taking all the way. Let's see. 2-0 count. Moose is set. And looks back, bluffs to throw back to second base. The Pirates had their play on where Alley, the shortstop, goes to third and Hebner charges in. Robertson in front of Menke at first. Moose stomps at the rubber. Now the right-hander is set. A check and the pitch on the way. Geronimo swings and misses. 2-1. So the Reds had him swinging at the first pitch. 2-1 the count. Jack Fillingham and Jim McLaughlin throwing in the bullpen for the Reds. Nelson Bryles and the Pirates fan. On deck for the Reds is Darryl Sweeney. Moose checking as the sign. And the 2-1 pitch, Geronimo bunts foul off to the left, so the count is now 2-2. So Bob Moose in a key pressure situation has gotten two strikes on Cesar Geronimo. 2-2 the count. Now let's see how the Pirates play it. Moose is talking with Gene Alley, the shortstop. Crowd gets going wild. Hardly have to tell you that. Here's the 2-2 pitch on the way. Swung on, hit in the air to deep right field. Clemente going back, and he will make the catch on the warning track. Foster tags at second. On his way to third, the throw is cut off. So the pennant's now at third base on a long out. We have one out, a long out, deep enough to get Foster to third. Pennant at third base. Menke at first base. Burden is going to the mound. Darryl Sweeney is the hitter. Clay Carroll is due to bat after Sweeney. The Reds have extended Ulander and Hague as pinch hitters today. They have Hal McRae on the bench, a right-hand batter. Bill Plummer could conceivably pinch hit. Julian Javier, should Cheney be unable to get the winning run home. The Reds, 3 runs, 7 hits, and 1 error. The Pirates, 3 runs, 8 hits, and no errors. Foster at third. Menke at first. One out. Bottom of the ninth. The game tied 3-3. To Cheney, Darryl takes low, ball one. 1-0. Clarky Anderson not tipping his hat. If Burden wanted to, he could demand that somebody be placed in the on-deck circle, and I'm sure Anderson would put Carroll out there, so that would be fruitless. Clarky will not tip his hand as to who would bat next. At the belt. Here's the 1-0 pitch on the way. Cheney fouls it back, and the count is 1-1. Hebner at third, in very shallow. Alley and Cash both up. Robertson at first base, just behind the runner. Again. Here's the 1-1 pitch. A pitch out. Nothing doing. The Pirates thought the Reds might have to squeeze on it. 2-1. Danny waiting. Darryl from Hammond, Indiana. Platoon, the shortstop this season with Dave Concepcion. It's 250. Moose ready. Here's a 2-1 pitch. Cheney swings, pops it in the air to shallow left. Dean Alley is going out. Bennett is coming in, and they come together, and Alley makes the catch, gets it in, and the run has to hold at third. So Cheney cannot deliver. He pops out to the shortstop as Bennett and Alley both come together. So there's two down now, and the Reds need more than a fly ball to win the game. And Hal McRae comes up to pinch hit for Clay Carroll. Pinch hitting. He was the Reds' most productive pinch hitter this year. He was 10 for 40, hit 250 as a pinch hitter, and four pinch hit home runs. Batted 281 during the year with five home runs, 26 runs batted in. Billingham and McLaughlin in the bullpen. It'll be one of them if we go to extra innings. Foster at third. Mankey at first. Two down. Moose checking with Sandian. The stretch. And the pitch on the way. McRae swings and misses. One after a slider on the outside corner. 0-1. To the Pirates. Trying to stay alive after it looked like they were gone. Justy went to 2-0 on Geronimo. Moose came in. Got Geronimo. Got Cheney. And now it's up to McRae. A tie game. Bottom of the ninth inning. Stands on the first base side of the rubber, takes off a sign. Now in agreement, he's set, and the strike one pitch on the way is outside, ball one. 1-1. On deck, Pete Rose. Moose turns his back on the plate. Back of the rubber now, kicking at the rubber. Mops his brow. Punches over, takes the side. The stretch, and the 1-1 pitch to McRae. In the dirt, it's a wild pitch. Here comes Foster. The Reds win the pennant.
Cincinnati, Foster scores, it's all over. It's the Reds against Detroit or Oakland on Saturday. Back with the totals and highlights right after this message.
Well, what a finish and what a doubleheader today, huh? How about that? In the Detroit game, Oakland looked like they had it sewed up, and they went down the bottom of the 10th and they scored. And that was unearned, and now we have an unearned win here. Another thriller in Cincinnati. Pittsburgh leading 3-2, had blanked Pittsburgh in the 6th, 7th. Another had blanked Cincinnati in the 6th, 7th, and 8th, and the Reds come up with an unearned run, a wild pitch, and you know how bad Bob Moose must feel right now for Pittsburgh. One of the veterans of the Pittsburgh staff throwing it into the dirt, back to the backstop, Foster coming in from third with the winning run, and the Cincinnati Reds now will face either Oakland or Detroit, and we won't know that until Thursday. And they have some red faces in Detroit today. They already had the Will Heritage Trophy with a plaque written on there. Oakland A's already screwed on, and they had to change that. They had to take the nameplate off after Detroit
came back to win that second game for them this year. Now for the wrap-up, let's go back to Cincinnati.
Totals at Riverfront Stadium, a place that has gone absolutely berserk. The Reds, 4 runs, 7 hits, 1 error. The Pirates, 3 runs, 8 hits, and no errors. Clay Carroll, the winner. Dave Justy, the loser. Johnny Bench ties the game in the ninth inning with a home run. And then Bob Moose, who looked like he was on his way to working out of a crucial situation, wild pitched home the winning run. So the Reds win it 4-3. 2 days off. Game one of the World Series here on Saturday on NBC TV. I'll be there along with Kurt Gowdy and Tony Kubek. Jim Simpson will handle the radio along with either Monty Moore or Ernie Harwell, depending on who wins Detroit and Oakland. And a reminder, tickets are now on sale at Riverfront Stadium for the World Series. For those of you around the country, we hope you've enjoyed the series. For those of you on the Reds Baseball Network, we know you've enjoyed the series. And we'll be going down to the locker room with Joe Nuxdahl. So.
Now we go to the Cincinnati Reds clubhouse for a start of the game. That's Joe Nuxdahl.
John Sala, thank you very much. And a very, very bunch of happy people here in the Cincinnati clubhouse. Johnny Bench down at the other end of the clubhouse right now. Most of the players are away from us at the present time. But we're going to be talking to as many as we can get here. And we want to talk if we can find Don Gullett, who started the game. Don, at one time, a very dejected little man. But now, as happy as he can be, the Reds winning the game. And just unbelievable the way the game finished. And I was in the clubhouse at the time Johnny Bench hit a home run. And then I was certainly here when the wild pitch was made and the Reds won the National League Championship. And we'll be back with more from here at the clubhouse at Riverfront Stadium after this word.
We have with us the starting pitch of the day, Don Gullett. And Don, I know how bad you felt the way things went early, but now as happy as anybody in this clubhouse. And what can you say? A great, great day for the Reds.
Certainly was, Joe. I don't think anybody's any happier now. It was. Right now, at the time, like you say, I wasn't happy that I came out of the game. Sparky came out, and just to show you positive thinking, Sparky says, well, Don, you just don't have it today. He said, maybe you'll have it Sunday. And then that gave me a big lift right there to tell me that we was going to go on and win the ball game and not be in there again Sunday. It's a great feeling, Joe. I'm happy for everybody.
Now we're going to get the old dog over here, Tony Perez. Tony, come on over here. Tony.
Thank you, Joe.
Yeah, man, it's okay. Great job. You know what? You just knew you were going to get in that last time up, didn't you?
Well, yeah, when you need it.
You did a great job, Tony. Congratulations.
Thank you, Joe. Thank you.
Hey, how about the World Series?
Oh, man, then we're going to have a picnic over here.
We'll get Rose over here. Pete. Nice going, partner. Great series. Great series.
Joe, I'm just so thrilled. I don't know what to say, Joe. When Bench hit that home run, that's the greatest feeling I ever got in my life, and it was the most excited I ever gotten. And I just was so happy that Johnny would thought enough to go the other way, because Jesse was going to go away with him with 2 strikes, and he just did his thing. I swear, I told him, I beat him out of the box. When he hit the ball, I knew it was gone. I was out of the dugout cheering it on. He wouldn't even out of the box. But we still had to get another run, but that stimulated us. And he's been doing it all year. He's been doing it. He did it in 1970, and I'm just happy. We're going to World Series this year healthy, and we're going to win it.
Great day on the first of the ball game, Frank. You don't have tears in your eyes, do you?
I have had all afternoon, right after that hit. And why couldn't you and Al sit down once you were standing and pacing in the thing? What was going on up there?
Our chairs were broken.
Wasn't that something unbelievable? You cannot imagine. This is a perfect National League finish. It's tough for Pittsburgh to take, but that somebody's got to do it. And that home run was just unbelievable. And did you notice that Johnny's mother came over screaming for him to do it? He did it, turned around and looked at her, and she came down by the fence. Great big tears all over her face. Just unbelievable. One of the highest emotions you can possibly have.
Thank you. Of course, this has been a super year, and what an absolute fantastic finish to a great season.
Joe, one thing needs to be said, and I will say it a number of times. When we were down and the crowd was a little quiet and so forth, but they got up in the eighth inning. They came out. The fans really came on, and in the ninth they were behind them. And the fans, you can't tell me that the fans don't play a great part. They do, and it's a tremendous thing to see this stadium full of fans to bring that team on, and they did it. They really did. The fans came up. And great year for you, Joe. Thank you for being with us.
Mr. Bob Hausman, the executive vice president, general manager. Robert, 2 out of 3.
Yes, sir. This is the greatest show I ever had, Joe. I mean, we wanted it so bad. When I say we, the whole organization from, well, there wasn't anybody in it that didn't want it. I say, and the ball players proved that they wanted it most out on that field.
Bobby, you know, Mr. Dale was just pointing out the fans, but I don't think from the first inning on, really, it was just utter chaos all over the ballpark.
They stood up and started cheering in that ninth inning before it ever come. And this big son of a gun, you know, he hit the ball over, and he promised me he was going to hit a home run, really. And I told my wife, after he got 2 strikes, I said, he's still going to hit that home run, and I'll be a son of a gun to the opposite field.
Thank you, Joe. Bob came by yesterday and said, oh, you're going to hit some today? And I said, yeah, I'll hit a couple for you. I'm going to hit a couple for you, and then I'm going to get one tomorrow. Talking about today, well, the 2 yesterday happened to be steals. And then he came by this morning, he came by the table, and he said, I said, well, I told you I was going to get 2 yesterday, but I am going to get one today. I felt it. I really did. I felt it the whole game, and I told Pete in the dugout in the first, second inning, I said, I hope there's a man on in the ninth.
Pete, John, you went the opposite way, but only the second time this year, possibly, that you hit an opposite field home run.
Joe, you got laryngitis there, Joe.
Well, yes, it was, Joe. It was the second time I went there. In fact, I did it against the Pirates one time.
It happened to be against the Pirates, against Luke Walker, and he hit the ball that way. And I don't know when there's ever been a bigger home run, unless some of them might hit off you in batting practice.
I knew I'd have to come into this.
John, it's a great thrill, Joe, and I'm glad
you're a
part of it.
After a while, you'd come back and take over. Okay,
thanks,
all right, partner. Johnny Bench and Mr. Bob Hausman, and Bob, of course, now the World Series for the second time in 3 years. And you were talking about the fans, what a great group it was here for every game. Really, we had a lot of people in Pittsburgh. We had a great crowd here, very enthusiastic.
Well, I tell you, the fans can thank Joe. We had great fans in the stadium, as you know. But I want to say this, that you fellows that have brought the game, and I listened to every word you made today, is, you know, you brought so much enjoyment and so much fun to a lot of people, not just because we won, but because you did all over this world. And to me, that's what really makes baseball and makes sports great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Al, and thank you, Joe, for this. Now we got to go into that World Series and do the same thing.
Right. I got to talk to my partner. I'm afraid he's going to collapse. He's been running around.
I'm talking to him. How are you?
You made it all right.
Made it. Hey, where are we?
Like I pointed out about Al, he looked like a caged tiger in our broadcast booth, and eventually he had me doing it. You can't believe the scene, Al, down here in the clubhouse as the guys came in, but Johnny Bench hit the home run. It looked like love story down here. Everybody.
Where were you when Bench hit the home run? You left the come down. Where were you?
I was back here watching it on TV.
Who was in here?
Joe Haig, Ted Uhlander, Hal McRae was loosening up because he knew he was going to pinch hit, and it's just an unbelievable story.
Oh, incredible. I don't know. I don't even know where I am when I'm talking about. You know?
Hey, we'll be back with more.
I want to say before you go to commercial, you are the most fantastic partner a guy fan has for. And I'm not, this isn't a mutual admiration society, but we have had some fun this year.
You better believe it. And you're going to have a lot more for us all over, big boy. We'll be back with more from the clubhouse at Riverfront after this part.
Once again, Joe Nuxall.
All right, John, thank you very much. And right now we have the mayor of the great city of Cincinnati with us, Mayor Tom Lucan. And Tom, I guess, well, your first time to be a part of a National League champion.
Oh, it's great. It was great in Pittsburgh to come home on a winning note. And we said Johnny Bench was a great base dealer, but today he showed what he really was.
Tom, did you have any kind of a little bat or something going with the mayor of Pittsburgh?
Well, he didn't seem too confident. He didn't even come over here. We went to Pittsburgh. I don't think he ever did expect to win. He knew we had it. He knew that Johnny Bench was going to come out with that home run. We thought we had 2 back-to-back there, but it came through. It's great. And I don't care whether we go to Detroit or Oakland. Makes no difference. We can win either way.
Very true. Mayor Lucan, thank you very much.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Hal McRae, come over here. Hal, 1, 2, 3. Hey, Harold.
Harold, you got up there. What did you think when Mr. Moose was out there?
Well, I thought I was going to do it when I first went up to the plate. After I swung at that bad slider, I had to regroup. I said, you can't swing at bad pitches. You got to get a good pitch. You know he's going to throw your slider, so you got to make sure you get a good pitch and try to put the bat on the ball. I felt I was going to do it, but I wrote it for him to do it, didn't I?
Of course, Hal, really, I know I've talked to you many times, and you always said, as a pitcher, you've got to go up there swinging the bat.
Yeah, I knew I had to go swinging the bat, and I was just a little too quick. I knew he was going to throw me sliders. I got one, but I swung too quick. I didn't wait long enough, and the ball was a couple of feet outside, but I don't think I was going to swing at another bad slider because I knew I had to do it, you know. After John hit the home run with two strikes on to the opposite field, I knew we were going to win it. It was two outs, runners on first and third. I had to do it, and I felt I was going to do it, but I was glad he made the wild pitch.
You know, it was a funny thing. I was walking through the clubhouse, and I said, wild pitch, and dadgum if it wasn't a wild pitch.
Yeah, I saw the ball go by San Quentin. I jumped up in the air and I saw Alex and George come across the plate, and I guess that was about the happiest feeling of my life.
Great, Al. Congratulations.
Thank you, now.
Okay. Chubb Feeney, the president of the National League. Chubb, I don't think there's any way in this world that you could ever ask for a better championship series than this one.
No, I don't think we'll ever have another one like that. There are just two great ball clubs, and it had to go down to the last. Last inch, the last thing at the wire was very, very exciting, and now we're going to go in the World Series and win.
Chubb, did you feel like it would go this way?
Yeah, I thought it would, and especially towards the late innings of the game, of course. Looked like the Pirates might break it open early, but when it got close, it had to go down to the ninth inning, Chubb.
Well, thank you, Chubb. Cesar Geronimo, Cesar, you hit a home run, foul, a big one, and then your fly ball, of course, the runner in scoring position, and you're not happy, are you?
Well, I think it's bad to win like this, but it's so great to win the winning team. I'm just so glad. Not glad, just glad.
How about the day you came over here from the Houston Astros? Did you dream of this?
Well, I was glad at the time, but not so glad like I feel right now.
Great. Say sorry. Congratulations.
Thank
Joe
you.
Morgan. Oh, Joe, come here. Hippity hop. How you doing, partner?
I feel great. My heel doesn't hurt me at all right now.
You're not mad at anybody, are you?
I'm not at anybody. It's
all
great.
Right.
This is great. This is great. Thank you very much. I'm just happy that I got over here.
How's your ankle now?
Well, it's bothered me quite a bit, but I got 2 days of rest. I'll be all right.
All right, yo. Nice going. Joe. See, great. Come here, great. But I'm sorry, Birmingham.
Always like you on these kind of shows.
Boy, you're a little in doubt, huh?
Had to go right down to the half of the last inning, Joe, because that's the way our ball clubs operated all year. Absolutely fantastic. I guess George got tired of giving him instructions, but I wanted to make sure there was no mix-up. I even told him, I said, now he's going to be throwing sliders to Mac. Be sure you gets away from the catcher. He'll be trying to keep it down. If he gets away from him, we got to score you somewhere or another. And doggone if that's not what happened.
And it did.
And I almost scored before he did.
Alex, Tom Hall, come here, Tom. Tom Hall, you rascal, you. Another great job.
Oh, thank you, Joe. Thank you.
You didn't get the hit, though.
No, I didn't get the hit, but I'm glad we won it there today. That's all right. Long as we win.
Tom, how'd you feel? You pitched four innings the other day. Did you feel good today?
Yeah, I felt real good out there. I felt fastball was pretty good. Flat and curved, everything was working pretty good today. And I just went out there and tried to give them all I had while I was there, Joe.
I'd say you did a good job.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right. Gary Nolan. Gary, come here, babe. Come here, Sarge. Sarge, how about it?
Joe, this is the greatest thing. 1970 was fantastic, but this is a super year.
This is a year
for a super team.
Fantastic bunch of people.
Oh, gripes. They fought back so hard today. I'm crying on the bench at night the way they're fighting back. I mean it. I was so happy for each and every one of our ball players, our leaders, our managers, our coaches, our announcers. It's been great all year, and we deserve it. Pittsburgh played a great series. They had a great team, two great teams played, and that's what counted.
Very well fit. Great. I know we're celebrating here, but how do you feel, really?
Well, I feel great. I'm so happy for everybody. Physically, I think the only thing I am is a little out of shape. But I'm going to go bust my rear end like I always do, and I know we're going to be tough.
All right, Gary.
Thank you very much.
Gary Nolan. Bobby Nolan. Hey, big boy.
Oh,
great.
Here we go.
Hey,
I got your big boy. Get your
headphones. It was great. This is a great win. We cannot win a better game than this here. It's been a great year enough. This is a temper right here. A lot of people kept bringing trade back in our faces that we can't win because we gave away Lee May, Joe Morgan, and Geronimo. Those guys are not going to help us. They didn't know about Bobby Tolan was going to come back. Bobby Tolan came back. The trade came out. They say Geronimo was a sleeper. He's not a sleeper. first major league ball player. He got the home run, important sacrifice fly, moving around over third base, and we kept battling back. We didn't give up to show you that we have the makings of a one hell of a ball club, Nuss.
Bob, congratulations. Thank you
very much. Right. The greatest thrill of my life.
All right, buddy. Pete, I never thought I could ever do a somersault. 250 pounds and do a somersault. I think I did it right in the club.
Oh, I tell you, Joe. I'm the happiest man in the world right now. Gene Smith wants to waste all his good champagne. I just wish you were a member of the team. I know how happy you are inside. They said Al Michaels was going to dance up there and back and forth.
Michael.
Hey, Hawk.
Nice shot,
Hawkey.
$90 champagne play, man. I didn't mean to yell into my
show. We're all happy.
I
hate to think what's going on uptown right now.
I do too. If nobody's drunk, we ain't drunk either. But everybody's going to be drunk, and we're going to be drunk. You ever heard of the balls we're not drinking? We drank enough. This is the time to drink, Nuck. Champagne, beer, liquor, or what, man?
All right, big boy. Congratulations. I'm going to turn it over to Al because I'm having a little problem.
Hey, man.
Right now.
Hey, he's doing all right.
I'm having a little problem. I'm going to scout
you. All right, baby. Where are we? At the end of your show?
We got more to go.
This is Joe Nuxall. Reminding you to stay tuned for scores and comments next.
All right.
You're going by car, but right at the moment, that must be a long, long way away.
Hey, I tell you, that's a little long way from the numbers. I'm telling you, this is one of the greatest days of my life right now. All the guys sitting down, it's just great, I tell you.
Where were you when it all happened?
Sitting there rooting on, I'm telling you.
On the bench?
Yes, that's right. I'm telling you, that was the greatest thing. I'm glad we won it that way, too.
We read about you guys on the bench. We read about you guys yesterday yelling, screaming. What about today? Was it the same thing?
Same thing. We wanted to give all the support we could. Even though we couldn't be in there, we still a part of it, and we wanted to root the guys. It was just great.
Andy did a beautiful job. Held us out in a lot of key spots this year. Go get him in the series, baby.
Thank you.
That's Lane Simpson. We'll be back with more from the Reds Clubhouse right after this message. Again, if you just woke up, you missed some day. Both the American League and the National League. In the American League today, the Tigers had their backs to the wall. Game number 4. They started the day down 2-1. It was tied 1-1 going into extra innings in the 11th inning. Oakland came up with 2 runs, and it looked like the A's had the pennant wrapped up. Detroit came back with 3 before Oakland could retire anybody in the bottom of the 11th. And so the Tigers won the game 4-3, and they set up the same situation we had here today. Tomorrow at Tiger Stadium in Detroit at 1:30 Eastern time, it's all on the line. The Detroit Tigers against the Oakland Athletics for the winner. Meeting the Cincinnati Reds in the first game of this series, the World Series, at Riverfront Stadium Saturday at 1 o'clock. We want to remind you, tickets on sale now outside. And ticket office open tonight until 9 o'clock. Games 1, 2, 6, and 7 will be played here at Riverfront Stadium. Games 3, 4, and 5 in the American League Park. Box office open tomorrow. 9 o'clock in the morning. So the Tigers and the A's have to go at it again tomorrow, and for the Reds, a wild night of celebration, I'm sure, will begin all over the city of Cincinnati.